Hi all, this is BRR. Today's session topic is ASP.NET caching. So not only ASP.NET, so same thing can be used in ASP.NET MVC as well. So what is caching static files content in ASP.NET? So generally caching static content such as images, JavaScripts and CSS files can be drastically improve the performance of your website if you cache these things into your browser or your disk. So generally, what it is going to give an advantage for the developer and the website is so no need of going to the web server each and every time for the static files which are coming from the web server, like this JavaScript files or cascading style sheets or XML files. Or you can say images kind of thing can be cached into browser, and next time onwards you can get it from the browser itself, so that it will boost up your performance. So we will know so many things, like we have seen in HTML files or not only images and JavaScript files and VBS files also, and other CSS files which are explicitly giving in the ASP or HTML files. So all these static things can be cached into browser. So why we use cache generally? General perception, like for the developer or like anyone who is working on to the website development, so they will be thinking of like why we require caching. Generally, caching content it can reduce the latency is nothing but the response time by surviving the requested resource from the cache instead of from the web server, thereby reducing server load basically. So generally it can reduce the latency time, so that you will get the response very fast from the browser instead of going to the server. Thereby, definitely will reduce the load onto the server on concurrent users visiting your website. And second thing is, since cached resources are saved locally on the client browser machine, so they can be reused and retrieved almost instantly. So we can spontaneously or we can immediately can be retrieved and reused from the browser. This also reduces the bandwidth used by the client, leading to faster page loads. Yeah, absolutely, because the things are coming from the local, and local in the sense of the browser also in the local machine, and definitely you will get more faster comparing to the original request or the file response coming from the web server, which is located in some other area but not in your local area. So definitely it reduces the network bandwidth, and almost we can instantly retrieve from the client. So this leads the fast performance of your page load. Now, so how do we let client browser know when to cache a file? So basically, how browser is knowing that, when it is going to cache the file. When a file is requested from the web server, the request associated with it contains response and request address. Generally, When you make a request to the web client web server, we'll be sending some HTTP address like content type and the response headers and the expiry date, like accept range. So there are some headers we'll be having in the HTTP headers in the request. So the request which is associated with response and request headers, which contains the information that is required by the browser, so that it will cache the file. So by modifying the headers, we can let the browser know that, like, if the file is needs to be cached or not, how long the file needs to be cached, whether the cache needs to be public or private, whether a file needs to be refreshed or not. These kind of things the browser can be knowing from the request. The request has all these stuff basically. Now, how we are going to add these all things in the request header? By default, it won't. Some of the headers can be added, but caching cannot be added to your request header. So you have to manually explicitly you have to say to the request that so and so request header has needs to be added to your request. Then only the browser can know that like some different header has come to the request, come in the request, and they will act based on the response header, request header. So how we are going to adopt this caching? Okay. So by configuring the cache settings, like to enable cache in ASP.NET application, we need to correctly configure the settings we require by modifying the web.config. So all the changes we need to perform need to be done is the below one. Like, so under system.webserver section in the config file, so we need to add this section like system.webserver static client. In this client cache, cache control mode user max age. Cache control max age is one day. This is days, hours, minutes, seconds. So always it gives you a total time in seconds. If I say like we mentioned 1 day, so 1 day means 24 hours multiplied by 60 minutes multiplied by 60 seconds. So totally 86400 seconds. This will cache the file static content. So above the system.webserver, you can mention the location tag. So there you can specify like location of your file. Like sometimes in the static files also, you have a need like, you know, every time you want to download it from server, one of the static file where it has dynamic content. So sometimes you may want to download it from browser cache. That scenario, so you don't want to cache entire folder where it has all static contents. You want to specifically cache the specific file. Then you mention using location tag here. Okay, let's see like how we are going to do practically. We'll show you like how it is going to behaves the HTTP header and now it behaves HTTP header after adding a cache. If you look at this particular screenshot here, so before add that particular sections into your cache things, so the screenshot looks like content like accept ranges bytes and accept control allow origin, content length, content type, something it can be shown before adding of it. And it will add some e tag. This is what the tag, like entity tag, where it has the entry in web server, so that when again you send same request to the web server, like this e tag or entity tag, like I said, it's a part of HTTP generally, the protocol for the World Wide Web. So several mechanisms that HTTP provides for web cache validation, which allows a client to make conditional statement on this subsequent request. So server may now compare the client's e tag with the tag which you are sending from the browser for the current version of the resource. If the tag value matches, like the resource has not been changed, then it will get it from the browser cache. So based on that, it will decide. So this is a unique value every time it will be sending it. So if you look at if you go and see website, I can say this is my website. I go and check this is my website where I have a page, like a registration page, where I have a username, nano email and password and confirm password. So when I give all these details and when I press save button, it will save into database after validating like this user is existed in the database or not. This is what the screen I have built in. So in this screen, I have, they given some references. If you look at this, my registration page, I have given some references like jQuery library and LoadMask library. And this is one of cascading style sheet LoadMask CSS and styles.css. So how these are going to be cached when it comes to browser looks like sending a request basically. So in this case, what is happening is, so if I browse it same page here, and if you look at this FTOL and go to this network tab, if you see, I'm deleting temporary files which are already cached into browser. If I press the send this request again to the web server, I will see like jQuery.js or Minifier.js and load more CSS and style.css. This status 200, that means the request has been processed properly. Okay. And these are the sizes of each and every file, like 298 KB and 2.3 KB, 1.4 KB. And this is the time taken to process the request from from the client to server, and the server sending response time. This is now, if you look at this particular so-called jQuery.js, if you look at this HTTP header here, this response header, as I shown you in the PPT file, it has accept ranges, bytes, access control allow origin stored. That means it will allow in the cross domain also, like sometimes you may access this file or this particular HTML file in the cross domain where it is deployed on the different machine, different domain. So this is content length, total content length of your file, and content type and date, e tag. So as I told you, this is the e tag generated by the server and assigned to your request HTTP header. This is the entity tag and kind of protocol where the sending request to the response from the web server to the web client. So this is the last modified date. This has been modified so and so, and this is the server, and this is the X frame options, and this is the compatibility mode something. So these are the things which are embedded in the response header. Now, so how browser can identify like this, so particular request is going to be cached or not? So if you look at this response headers, nowhere mentioned that this request is going to be cached in the browser, right? That's why it is caching. I mean, it is coming from every time from the a web server. Now, how you are going to cache this? So go and see the web.config of this particular thing, as I mentioned in the PPT. So go to this particular system.web section, and you add client cache settings in the config file for the so-called request like jQuery.js. So what is that section I mentioned? Oops, I forgot it. So see. Okay. This is the thing I'm going to add it. So I have been added here, my location path is web test harness in the scripts folder, jQuery.js file, this is my location path. And I'm adding this client caching mode is user max, and this is the time I'm going to cache one day. And if you specify like this and you save it, and now you run it, like we'll delete again temp files, if anything, because by nature Chrome will cache things. So if you run it, very fast time it goes to the web server and it has been get all this stuff here. And if you look at this particular jQuery.js, you see this new thing has been added here. This is cache control max is 86400 seconds. So as I told you that, so once you add a particular section in the config file, it will add this particular the header in the response header, so that browser knows that this is going to be cached till this particular time. Okay, this way you can cache, and this way you can let to know browser like when it is going to be cached something. Okay, so this is what I mentioned here. This is before adding of your cache sections. This is after adding of your cache sections. Okay, client cache may contains below attributes. So only one of the thing we use this cache control maxes, and this may contains cache control mode like no control, disable cache, and user maxi and user expires, and HTTP expires set tag. So this actually specifies the number of days or number of kind of seconds or minutes going to cache. And this is disable cache, and no control does not add a cache control or expiry header to the response. By default, numeric value is 0. And user maxi numeric value is 2, and this is 1. And user expiry. So this attribute you can mention the date. If you know like I want to cache like tomorrow 12 p.m. Or 1 p.m. something, so you just mention this user expiry directly in the config file. And similarly, HTTP expires, and this set tag. Set tag, if you want to generate it, by default it will generate. If you don't want to generate it, then you say that this is false in the config file, so that it won't generate. Like if you look at our I say set e tag is false, If I say this particular value, it tag. If I say this particular tag, then this thing will not generate when you browse the request. Let's see. Generating cache and running my application. If you look at here, you didn't see tag here because that tag I have turned off. So only cache tag has been generated and added to your response header. No e tag has been generated. So if you want it, you can generate it. Otherwise, you have that by using a set e tag as false. Okay. So now, so these are the things that you can include if you want more onto the particular client cache settings. Hope this clears how to add client cache and how to how browser knows like which kind of request is going to cache and which kind of file it is going to cache kind of thing based on your location path. Hope this clears like how to cache and how to specify the path in the web.config so that browser can cache and send the request response with the specified header to the browser. Oops, this is my last screen slide always. So thank you.